The campaigns of Alexander the Great speak to the imagination, especially due to the role of Alexander as a cavalry commander. He didn't seem to hesitate to charge into the enemy ranks with his companion cavalry in the heat of battle. In this episode, I want to talk about the origins, the performance, and the downfall of the companion cavalry as an elite force. The name companion cavalry is derived from the Greek word hertaroi, which means close to the king. The companions were generally members from the aristocracy who were selected to go with the king on campaign by the means of transportation for the wealthy and powerful on horseback. This was by no means a novelty in Alexander's age. Ancient Greece knew numerous examples of this kind of mounted bodyguards units, like the Hippies in Sparta. I deliberately speak of mounted troops because most of the time they would dismount before going to battle as foot soldiers. Horsemen reflected the wealth of a particular class and were mainly used as light cavalry to harass the enemy or pursue them, rather than engage the enemy head-on in battle. The question is, why did cavalry become more important in ancient Macedon? Some scholars point at the Theban general Pelopidas as a major influence on the positive attitude of the future king Philip II of Macedon towards cavalry. This is debatable, however, because it's also possible that Philip II started to appreciate the use of cavalry during the Third Sacred War between 356 and 346 BC, when he mustered the Thessalians in his army. Thessaly was known for its potent cavalry force. After the war, Philip got full control over Thessaly and its army. It's likely that he expanded his companion cavalry in order to integrate the Thessalian upper class into his army. The companion cavalry was, in other words, used as a political tool to integrate the elite. It is often assumed that Alexander played an important role in his father's cavalry. Alexander's early role in the companion cavalry is fraught with assumptions and even legends. An ancient anecdote by Plutarch portrays Alexander the Great as a natural horseman. In this story, young Alexander tames an expensive but unruly Thessalian warhorse, which his father subsequently buys for him. It became his personal horse, Bucephalus, which went with him all the way to India. It is a beautiful story, which fits Alexander's self-image of an ambitious man who was destined to lead the companion cavalry. In this story, he supposedly had the endorsement of his father for his conquests by the word, "O my son, look thee out a kingdom equal to and worthy of thyself, for Macedonia is too little for thee." When Alexander the Great came of age, the companion cavalry was already in existence as a cavalry force, but it's not likely that he would have commanded them at that stage, because the companion cavalry was the personal unit of the king. In Macedon, succession was no easy matter, as neither Alexander's father nor his grandfather became king by direct succession. In this light, it's understandable that Philip would be very reluctant to relinquish the command of a politicized force like the companion cavalry. The first major battle where Alexander is supposed to have commanded the companion cavalry is the Battle of Chaeronea against Thebes, because Philip and Alexander conducted this battle together. There is no evidence, however, that cavalry played any role in this battle, which seems more likely to be an old-fashioned clash of burly phalanxes. It was most probably not until the death of his father in 336 BC that Alexander assumed the command of companion cavalry as the new king of Macedon. Alexander's ascent to power was a rocky affair, just as the succession of his father and grandfather before him. He had to assassinate potential rivals and deal with uprisings. Alexander reacted swiftly and decisively. He assembled a large Macedonian cavalry force of 3,000 men and set out to defeat his enemies one by one. It was probably not only a sound military decision to put speed over strength, but also a political one. The cavalry represented the social elite, and Alexander's message must have been clear for his contemporaries. Take the opportunity to join me now, or fall out of grace forever. Alexander tested his reformed companion cavalry physically by demanding them to ride over the almost 2,000 meter high Mount Ossa. It was for the companion cavalry a taste of things to come. Alexander would spare neither foot soldier nor cavalryman to quench his ambitions of conquest, as we shall see. Alexander's swift campaign in Greece paid off. Most states surrendered before him. The only setback was the revolt of Thebes during the Thracian campaign. In both campaigns, the companion cavalry did not play a significant role. The Thracians defended themselves behind prepared defensive border palisades, and the Thebans behind their city walls. Those conflicts were characterized by sieges. It was probably not until Alexander's campaign in Asia that the companion cavalry would rise to military prominence. The Greek mountainous landscape and the Greek way of war had set constraints to the deployment of cavalry on the battlefield. No horse would charge into a phalanx with interlocking shields and bristling with spears, but the open plains of the Levant, on the other hand, would give the cavalry plenty of space for deployment on the battlefield. The deployment of his 1,800-man-strong companion cavalry during Alexander's campaign in the Levant is often described as a deliberate deployment of a shock troop. I will not dispute Alexander's bravery to put himself in harm's way, but I think the reality is more complicated. First of all, the companion cavalry was not similar to the medieval heavy cavalry of knights who plowed into the ranks of enemy infantry. It should be noticed that the companions had no solid saddle trees and stirrups, which are essential to prevent you from falling from your horse when you crash into the enemy's ranks. The companions were rather a light cavalry force which was deployed to exploit a breakthrough. They would exploit their elevated position to strike the infantry with their swords and short spears. This advantage cannot be underestimated, as it is used until this very day by mounted riot police, for example. It also meant that the cavalry had no obvious advantage over other cavalry, because they lacked the advantage of the charge with long lances. In my opinion, the use of companion cavalry on the battlefield against the Persians was a learning process for Alexander. In the first battle with the Persians, the battle on the Granicus, he noticed that the Persians were forming up against his right flank, where he was positioned with his companion cavalry. The Persians knew that Alexander would be where his companions would be, and that knocking him and his unit out would mean victory. As a result, he ordered a feint cavalry attack on his left flank to draw the Persian units away from his position. When he finally charged himself with his companion cavalry, the Persians counterattacked immediately with a cavalry detail, almost killing Alexander in the ensuing fight. Alexander was saved by one of his companions, Cletus the Black. I personally think that it was not Alexander's plan to draw the enemy's forces to himself, but in the end he won the battle and he learned to use this knowledge in upcoming battle with the Persians. The next great battle was the Battle of Issus. At Issus, Alexander showed that he had clearly learned from the fact that his presence and that of his companion cavalry attracted the Persian attention. As a result, he put the bulk of his cavalry on his left flank, making the Persians believe that he would strike from that direction. Alexander and his companions would position on the right flank, but they were dismounted, masking their presence by the pretense of being foot soldiers. The Persians took the bait and attacked the Hellenic cavalry on the left flank with their own cavalry force, which was much larger. Meanwhile, shield bearers from Alexander's right flank crossed the Issus on foot. After establishing a bridgehead, Alexander brought over his companion cavalry, mounted his horse, and struck with his companion cavalry against the position of the Persian king Darius in the center. As a result, Darius fled and the Persian army disintegrated. Despite Alexander's success, the Battle of Issus was a close call, because the overwhelming Persian cavalry had almost overrun Alexander's cavalry on the left flank. Two years later, Alexander would replicate the situation, exposing his army to the full weight of the Persian army in the open field of Gaugamela. This time, Alexander would deliberately ride out with his companion cavalry to lure the heavy Persian cavalry away from the main body of his army. With this move, he seems to ride away from battle, but his real aim was to create a gap in the Persian lines in which he could strike at Darius in the center. Just like at Issus, it worked, and the Persian army disintegrated when the rumors filtered through the ranks that the king Darius had abandoned them. In the battles of Issus and Gaugamela, Alexander used his companion cavalry as shock troops against infantry. This went well and the cavalry managed to break the enemy formations. When he used his companion cavalry against the Persian cavalry, however, the companions suffered heavy losses. After the companions shattered the Persian infantry at Gaugamela, they turned around to save the Macedonian infantry from the Persian cavalry. As a result, 60 companions died and many more were wounded. The Persian campaign saw an increased importance of the companion cavalry as a battlefield force, but as its deployment increased, its losses mounted. One can imagine that discontent rose as Alexander's army went deeper into the seemingly endless landmass of Asia. The last great battle of Alexander the Great, in which the companion cavalry played a significant role, was the battle at the Hydaspes River in India. In this battle, the companion cavalry is positioned on the right flank and charged the numerous Indian cavalry head-on. This was a deliberate move, because he knew that another cavalry force under his trusted general Guenes was attacking the Indian cavalry from behind. By his charge, he also meant to draw the enemy's attention to himself, meanwhile making the impact of Guenes' cavalry from behind all the more effective, as all Indians were focused on his presence. Nevertheless, the charge was a costly affair in manpower, and even Alexander suffered himself. His trusted warhorse Bucephalus was killed, and Alexander was wounded. By this time, the Macedonian army had had enough, and the soldiers revolted. They wanted to go home, and Alexander complied. Alexander had brought his trusted Macedonian soldiers beyond the edge of the known world. It was during the retreat of the Macedonian army through the desert that the companions suffered their greatest losses. More than 700 of them perished, and only 1,000 horsemen were left in the end. After these disastrous losses, Alexander halved the number of companion cavalry and began integrating Persian nobility into the companion cavalry. This was a political move to integrate the Persian elite into his army. We can see the parallel with the move of Alexander's father Philip, who had integrated the Thessalians into his realm by admitting their nobility into the companion cavalry. Alexander also arranged his generals to be married to Persian women from noble families to further integrate the Persian elite. All his efforts did not bring about the merged political elite for his newly won empire, however. On the contrary, it made the Macedonians resentful towards Alexander and the Persians. They saw Alexander was becoming more Persian inclined at the cost of his Macedonian identity, especially by adopting Persian traditions of kingship. The companions were no longer used as a military force and became once again the political tool it was under Philip of Macedon. It led to the demise of the companion cavalry as an elite force as a result of the loss of cohesion and military purpose. Perhaps there was even a transformation from warriors to courtiers, just like the medieval knights went through the same development. After Alexander died, the Macedonian armies split up in rivaling factions around his most famous generals. The companions disintegrated as a result of this fractured succession. New companion cavalry forces were formed around Alexander's successors, but there was no continuation with Alexander's own companions. Companions reflected the favor and ambitions of the king. Alexander's initial companion cavalry was a creation of Alexander and reflected his ambitions as a warrior king. We can conclude that the companion cavalry was a true elite force because they were a selected and dedicated force which was willing to follow Alexander wherever he went on the battlefield, even in peril of their own lives. Their presence would often betray Alexander's position on the battlefield and attract the enemy's forces like a magnet. Alexander found that out at Granicus, which almost had costed his life, but he exploited this knowledge in subsequent battles. That meant that the companion cavalry was used more and more like a cavalry shock force, rather than the traditional role of cavalry to pursue the fleeing enemy. They lost their elite status when Alexander chose to use it as a tool of political integration, which ultimately failed. If you like my content, don't forget to subscribe and click on the bell to get notifications for new content.